which is in the Centro de Investigación Príncipe Felipe. It's a research center in biomedicine and it's located in Valencia, here in Spain. So before starting with the lecture, I would like to introduce a little bit about our group. So the genomic gene expression group is really divided in two teams. One team is in the Centro de Investigación Príncipe Felipe, as I told you, and the other one is in the University of Florida in the USA. So the goal of our group is to understand the functional aspects of gene expression. And for that, we develop statistical methods, software tools, and we not only study gene expression, but all the regulation around the regulatory mechanisms behind gene expression. And also we are interested in isoforms and the functional implications of the alternative splicing. Just in brief, you have more information there. And also in our website. Okay, so in this lecture I'm giving you a lot of information. Don't worry if you think it's too much to understand now, because during the hands-on session we will review every part of it and we will practice every part of it. Okay, so let's start talking a little bit about omics and pipelines. So we have, although in this session we are especially interested in this part, in transcriptomics, you know that we have different omics to measure different aspects of the cellular behavior. In this course we will be especially focused in this part. I think we are not working with proteomics or metabolomics, but with transcriptomics and the relationships with other omics, and we are especially focused in next generation sequencing technologies. Okay, so there are many of them. We have, for instance, the DNA-seq to study the sequence of the genome, and then we have the RNA-seq to study the expression of the genes. But then, for the methylation, methyl-seq to study the chromatin accessibility with ATAC-seq or DNA-seq. GIP-seq to study the binding of transcription factors to the DNA, or to study the histone modifications. We also have microRNA expression that can regulate also gene expression, and I mean, many of them, to study the transcription rate, RNA-seq, or translation rate, the binding of proteins to the RNA. I mean, there are many of them. But in this session, or in this week, we will focus on, I think, on these three, mainly in these three omics. Maybe you will get some insights in other NGS technologies, but I think that the whole course is around these omics, these technologies. Okay. So, and what I'm going to do today. So, in principle, I had to talk about RNA-seq. But I have divided all the NGS technologies into groups, gene-based and region-based. And this is for the bulk, the technologies, the same would be for single cell, but I'm not talking today about single cell. You will see it during the week. So these NGS technologies, in RNA-seq, microRNA-seq, also RNA-seq and other technologies, what you study is, or what you get after processing the sequencing data, is information for the genes. In these other technologies, when you process the data, what you normally get is information about genomic regions. Okay, so I'm going to not to talk only about RNA-seq, but because some of the things I am going to tell you are also valid for other technologies, I will talk also about microRNA-seq, CIPF-seq, or ATAC-seq. And I mean, it doesn't mean that some of the things I say are not valid for other omics, but at least I will take profit of my session for you to know how to normalize or compute differential expression or whatever on RNA-seq, but also to this omics. Okay. So there is no time to explain the whole protocol of obtaining this the data from these technologies, but in very, very brief, in mathematics we have RNA-seq or CIPF-seq or whatever. We start with the library preparation, and then we go to the sequencing machine, and then we have our sequencing reads. Okay, so what to do with these sequencing reads? The first thing we have to do, it doesn't matter the kind of technology we have, is to map the sequencing reads to a reference genome. And maybe you are saying, okay, what happens if we don't have a reference genome? Is it possible also? We are not studying that in this course because if you have to do de novo assembly of the transcriptome or of the genome, it's out of the scope of the course, but it can be done. So imagine you have a reference genome, we are going to align the sequencing reads to the reference genome. If we have, for instance, RNA-seq or microRNA-seq, we will have RNA sequences, don't forget that. But if we have oral CIPF or ATAC-seq, we will have DNA sequences. Okay? So, with these gene-based technologies, which is the way to follow. So, the common or the popular or the most, I don't know how to say, the most usual way to do it is once I have the alignment of the sequence read to the reference genome, what I'm going to do is to see in my reference genome where are the genes and to count the sequencing reads falling into each gene. So this is what I do in this step, quantification, okay? I'm not talking about the software that we can use to do the mapping or the quantification. A popular software, for instance, for mapping is TopPath, or for quantification it's this account, but I'm not saying that they are the only ones and the best ones. They are popular tools, but there are many more. Okay, so if I'm having this RNA-seq data, I could also make this transcript discovery. So if I have the reference genome and the annotation of my reference genome in the GTF file, I'm working with known genes or with known transcripts. If I would like to study new transcript, it can be done with RNA-seq. I would prefer to do it with other kind of technologies, long read technologies such as PacBio. They are better to do this transcript discovery, but it still can be done with RNA-seq. Okay, so then we have to do this transcript discovery. Normally, you get different transcripts or new transcripts with the different biological samples you have. So if you have the whole experiment, you want to define consensus transcripts, and then you have this. Once you have this consensus transcript, you can go for the quantification. Okay, so in this course, we will follow this with this way. We will not speak about transcript discovery, but I wanted to mention it just in case you can need it for future work. Okay. So, and what happens with the region-based technologies? This is the way it's a bit different, because here we have the reads aligned to the genome, but then we don't have this GTF file with the annotation of our genes. We have to discover which are the regions in which, for instance, the transcription factor is binding to the genome, or there is a histone modification, or the chromatin is accessible. So you have to find the regions in the genome. And to find these regions, you have to perform peak coding. This is the type of algorithms that do these kind of things. So once you perform the peak coding, you find these regions, okay? So similarly to what happened with the transcripts, for each biological sample you have, you are going to find a different set of regions, okay? So if we want to put all our biological samples from the same experiment in common, because maybe I can stop here and I only want to consider the regions, but maybe I want to quantify also the number of reads falling into each region, because the higher the amount of reads falling into each region, the more evidence we have that this transcription factor, for instance, is binding to that region. Okay? So if we want to quantify and then to get a quantification matrix at the very end of the analysis to do the statistical part, then we need to have this common matrix, we have to define these consensus regions. Because as I said, for each biological sample, we will have a different set of regions. So we will see how to do that, or how to do that. Okay? So, as I told you, I have my gene-based technologies, I have the quantification, so I have different files, one for each biological sample, but all of them have the same feature identifiers, the same genes here, the same genes here, etc. So to start working with the statistical analysis, with the normalization step or whatever, I just have to put all of these files into the same and create a matrix, a quantification matrix. When I have the gene-based technologies, then I have the peak coding for the different sample. I have a different set of regions. Then I create or I obtain a set of consensus regions. And then once I have these consensus regions, I can quantify the number of reads falling into each one of them and get also a quantification matrix. And this is the point, this quantification matrix is the point where my lecture is going to start. I will talk, as I said, how to do this part, but I mean, I'm not going to talk about mapping or whatever. I'm going to start here, and from these counts, we are going to pre-process them to remove the technical bias, and then to perform the statistical analysis that will be used afterwards for the integration, for integration purposes. Okay? So, this is the step we are going to review in the lecture. First, we have the quantification, as I said, the quantification matrix, the count matrix. Then we will do an exploratory analysis to find if we have some technical biases there. We can also remove those genes that have low counts because maybe they are introducing noise in our analysis. We will talk more about this later. We perform the normalization, which is, as you know, to remove the or to reduce the technical biases. Then we explore again the data to see if we have corrected the biases and see if we have batch effects. This is very important. We will talk about them afterwards and see how to correct them if it's possible. And then the statistical part, the differential expression, to find which are the genes or the regions with significant changes across the conditions we are studying. And this is very important for the integration part. Why? Because we are going to have, when you have omics, you have a lot of features, you know, you have thousands of features, omic features for each different omic, then you are going to integrate them, so you are multiplying the dimension of your data, and then it doesn't make sense that you are including in your integrative analysis all those features that are not changing across conditions because they are not giving you information, and you are making the analysis, the integration analysis, more difficult. So a good filter to do is to start finding the features that are changing. And then, because these are the features that will give you biological information. So then you can, not in all of them, but in most of the integration analysis, you just consider these changing features. Okay? So we will see how to do it and how we did it in the StatTegra project. Then the functional enrichment. Why functional enrichment? Two reasons for that. One reason is a kind of quality control, because when you do functional enrichment, you are finding which are the biological functions that are more present in your differentially expressed features. So if these biological functions are, you see that are related with the process that you are studying, with your disease or whatever, then, I mean, it tells you, okay, the selection of differentially expressed features and the process I've done here is meaningful because I'm obtaining good information. And of course, the second reason is the information per se, because we have here, we have a first impression of what our data are telling us about the process we are studying, okay? And finally, once we have this, we can talk about integration. This will not be for my part, but during the week, you will see a little bit. Okay? So, let's start with the exploratory analysis to find bias detection. And of course, we will see first which are the possible technical biases you can find in this technology. So, the most important bias you can find is the sequencing depth. This is for all the technologies, because of course if you have the quantifications, the higher the sequencing depth, the higher the count you would have for the features. So if you have one sample and you have sequenced 1 million reads, and for the other sample you have sequenced 2 million reads, and then you have a feature with 100 counts and a feature with 100 counts, you cannot say that the feature has the same value, because it's not the same 100 counts in 1 million than in 2 million. So this is very important, it's very silly, but it's basic, you have to correct for that. But also, the sequencing depth is very related with the saturation and the efficiency. Saturation is more studied with when you have gene-based technologies, because you know the number of genes you have in your genome, and you study the saturation, which means I'm sequencing enough to get or to detect all the features in my genome, or at least all the features I'm interested in. Okay, so this is one question for the saturation. And the efficiency is normally more related with the region-based technologies. So the efficiency is the percentage of reads falling into the regions of interest. So if you have a low efficiency, it means that your reads are all over the genome and are not concentrated in the region of interest. If you have high efficiency, it means that most of the reads are accumulating in some regions, and this will be your regions of interest. Okay. Another possible bias you may have in sequencing technologies is the length of the features. Okay. So why quantification depends on the feature length? So if we have genes, longer transcripts, according to the protocol followed in RNA-seq technology, in which you divide the transcripts in several pieces, let's say, it's small fragments, then what you have is that the longer transcripts have more probability to appear. So are more represented, and expression tends to be higher for long transcripts. And we don't want that, because this is not true biology. It's only an effect of the protocol of the technology. Okay? For region-based technologies, this may also happen, because longer regions tend to accumulate more sequencing reads. Here you have an example, the same number of reads here and here, and this is a longer region, and I mean, seems that it's more important to have here, although you have the same count, if you correct by the original length, you will find that here it's more relevant to have the same number of reads in a smaller region than in a longer one. Okay, so another possible bias, I will call it read count distribution, or I mean that has a different name, is what happens with the read count distribution, which is here, between samples. And to see the meaning of this bias, let's go to the biological samples, to the truth, which is, I mean, I have this biological sample number one, and I have to match in these two genes, A and B. So these are the number of transcripts for gene A, and these are the number of transcripts for gene B, and the same for the biological sample 2. As you can see here, in both biological samples, gene B is equally expressed. It has the same number of transcripts. Now, we start with the sequencing, and imagine we sequence 100 reads. So, when I sequence 100 reads, I go to sample 1, and these 100 reads are equally or proportionally divided for the two genes. So this gene is more expressed, it accumulates a higher number of reads, and then we have 21 reads for gene B. When we go to biological sample 2, the same happens. The reads are proportionally divided into the two genes. But imagine what is happening here. Gene B, which was equally expressed in both biological samples, when we go here, you can see that in sample 2, the gene B is more expressed than in sample 1. Okay?
I'm assuming this is only a problem if you don't have UMIs in your library.
If you don't what?
If you don't have unique molecular identifiers in your
yes.
library.
I guess so. But this is what you have most commonly in this kind of data. Okay, so we, if possible, we want to correct for this situation also. Then another bias, which is a bias that happens with the Illumina technology, but Illumina is for RNA-seq, and this kind of technology is the most common one. So genes with is the GC content in the sequence of the genes. So the genes with low or high GC content tend to have lower expression estimation, as we can see in this plot. And again, this is not true in the biology. It's something you want to correct. Okay, so let's summarize the problems we may have, and as we're going to work from the. As we are going to start to work from the count matrix, let's see which of these problems can be identified for the different types of data, for RNA-seq, microRNA-seq, and general region-based data. Okay, so can we see if we have technical failures or contamination from the count data? So from the count data with RNA-seq, you can, with biotypes, studying the information of biotypes, and I will talk about this later on, we can at least have an idea of if we could be having some type of contamination or problem, okay? But it's not possible with the other technologies. The sequencing depth is very easy to detect this problem, and it can be done with all the technologies. The saturation, as I told you, is more for the gene-based technologies, so it's not possible for region-based, because in principle we don't know which is the number of region we should be detecting, so we cannot know if we are detecting all of them or not. The feature length, we can study for RNA-seq as for region-based. For microRNA-seq, it doesn't make sense, because as you know, microRNAs are short RNAs, and they are more or less the same length, and this bias is not affecting this type of data. With the GC content, we can detect it for all the technologies, also the different redistribution, and if we had a problem with low counts, we'll see how to study this problem in RNA-seq and microRNA-seq. Also, we can do it for region-based, but it's less common. Why? Because, if you have region-based technologies, you have done this step of peak calling, and then to detect a peak is because I have enough reads. So maybe I have this peak in one of my conditions, and I don't have the peak in the other condition, and then I have low counts in one of the conditions, but in at least one of the conditions I have, I must have a high amount of reads, because otherwise the region would have, or the peak would have had any call. Okay, so how can we perform the quality control of this quantification data? So I propose here to do that the package we have developed in our group, which is called NoiSeq. It's in the bioconductor repository. And NoiSeq is divided in three parts. There are some functionalities related to quality control. Some of them do normalization and filtering, and then the part of the differential expression. Okay. So this part, quality control, can be used to obtain several plots that will help us to know, and several also statistical tests to help us to know if we have the different technical biases and the was talking about. Okay, so we will see in the hands-on this how to interpret these plots, how to create them, and so on. And then once we have detected which are the technical biases we have in our data, how can we correct them? This is the normalization step. So different types of normalization we may have, and this is valid for all the omics. Now I will be telling you which things what I'm saying are valid for proteomics or for any of them. So we have two types of normalization, that is called within samples and with, between samples normalization. So what is within sample, mean within samples? It means that for the same sample, I'm only talking about one biological sample, then what I have is all the features and the quantification. And the idea for normalization is either do the features comparable or make the samples comparable. So imagine that I have one sample and I have my features and I have a problem with the length of the features. I have this bias. It means that if I have two genes that in the biology are equally expressed and one of them is longer than the other, maybe this gene got more counts, more read counts, okay? So what the length problem is that it's making that the features are not comparable. So I need for the length or for the easy content a within sample normalization. For instance, the sequencing depth, what the result of having a sequencing depth bias is that the samples are not comparable because I have, for instance, 1 million reads in one sample and 2 million reads in the other, okay? So between samples normalization, we correct this type of things, okay? So which methods do I have for to correct within sample? I have, I will explain more about them in a minute, RPKM, dose regression, approach quartile, this is a summary. And then there are other methods that are used to correct between samples. So note that there are some methods that correct for both. We will see in a minute that RPKM corrects for the length and for the sequencing depth at the same time, okay? So as I said, within samples to make coming features comparable and between samples to make samples comparable. So these methods are explained here in more detail. So total counts is simply you are going to correct just for the sequencing depth. So you can divide for the total number of sequencing reads in each sample, or for for the median, or for some proportional measure. Okay. Then they are RPKM. The gene counts are divided by the gene length in kilobases and the multiplied by the total number of millions of map reads. The upper quartiles, this method corrects for the sequencing depth, so you divide by the quartile. So you divide by the upper quartile of the total counts. The median is the same, but with the median. And then quantile is a method that was created for microarrays, and this method matches the gene count distributions across samples, okay? So matches all the percentiles of the data. More methods is, you have, for instance, TMM. TMM could be considered, it's more complex to explain, but it could be considered like a quantile normalization, but the quantile normalization is very aggressive. It makes all the samples perfectly equal, and maybe this is too much. So TMM is a kind of quantile normalization, we could say, but it gives freedom to the genes, if we are talking about genes, that are very lowly expressed and very highly expressed. So the central part of your features are the method makes them equal, but it gives more freedom to the extremes, let's say, okay? To do that, they apply this shader you have there. And the SEQ differential expression package, we have also a normalization that that is also kind of similar to the TMM normalization. Okay, so take into account that most of the normalization methods, or at least these two, have one assumption. Is that most of the genes are not differential expressed. If you are expecting that most of the genes in your experiment are changing, be careful with this type of normalization, okay? And also, be careful because sometimes, depending on the quantification methodology you are using, maybe the values you get are already normalized somehow. Okay, for instance, Coupling, which is also a popular software to among other things, return the quantification of the features, gives you the already normalized data because they return a kind of RPKM values, which are called FPKM. Okay. So, I don't know if this is a good example, I must admit it, but I mean, this is how the different methods would, not all of them, but some of them would normalize or would change the data. These are the samples here. And okay, so which is the best normalization method? There is a paper here, if you are curious about it's a good comparison of all the normalization methods. There is also this tool, I haven't checked this yet, but this tool is to compare, you apply the different normalization methods to your data, and then you can compare which is the best method. Okay, so what they say in this paper, basically, is that the normalization included in these SIG packets or anti-TMM, normally they return the best. Okay. So, and this is information for you. This is different packages, and think that all of them are in Bioconductor. And these are packages that have included some normalization procedure. Okay? So, some of the, as you can see here, some of the normalization methods we have mentioned are included. Okay, so we have normalized data, and now we are going to check if we can repeat the same exploration here to see if the biases have been removed. But then we want to also to explore the data to see if we have batch effects. Okay, so let's see this batch effect. So in this kind of experiments, in this couple of omics and multi-omic experiments, sometimes if you have many samples, it is very difficult that you process all the samples at the same time because you have different steps during from the very first step in which you get the biological samples until you prepare the libraries and the sequencing, you have the runs, the sequencing, so you have many, many steps. And then it's sometimes difficult if you have many samples to process all of them in the same machine, by the same person, at the same moment. So many times you have to split your samples into different batches, okay? So when you have to do that, you must be very careful because maybe these batches you are having have an effect that is more important that the effect of the factor you want to study. For instance, if you want to study a disease and you have control samples and you have disease samples, this is the most easy example. So if you have that and then you process because you don't have time to do or you it's not possible for you to do it at the same time and you process first all the control samples and tomorrow or the next week I process all the disease samples, then this effect of this batch maybe it's more important than the effect of the disease itself, okay? So it doesn't mean that you cannot split the samples into batches. Yes, you can do it, but you have to take into account that you have to randomize the sample, you have to split your samples randomly into each batch in order to be able to correct this batch effect afterwards, okay? So. And then for the sequencing, the same. You cannot in the same run put all the control samples and in the other run all the disease samples. You have to randomize or either use multiplexing for the sequencing. But I mean the batch effect or the problem of the batch can be present in all the steps of the analysis from the very beginning of getting the biological sample or extracting the sample until the end. So, what you have to do is always randomize your samples into each batch in such a way that the effect of interest, the steadiness or whatever, is not confounded with the effect of the batch. If the experiment is the experimental design is good enough, okay, then we'll have solutions for the batch effect. We can remove the batch effect with the statistical methods. But it's very important to have a very good experimental design, because statistical methods cannot make miracles. Okay, so if the experimental design is good, then we, and I say this a lot, because although I always warn about it, I always get experiments in which this is not has been taken into account, and then you cannot separate anymore the effects, and it's very hard to say to the researcher, okay, your data. Okay, so once we have this experimental design well done, how we can correct this batch effect, which is an unwanted effect. Okay, so we have several possibilities, and I'm going to mention two options that we normally use and that work quite well. So one of them is the method BOMBAT, and the other one is the method RNA-seq, which has been also developed in our group and is also included in the noise package. Okay? So, for combat, you must know where are your batches, because you have to give to the method the information of the batch. And the good thing of RNA-seq is that if you know how your batch were produced, you give the information of the batch. But imagine that you have public data. You can see when you explore the data that the samples are not clustering well, you don't have the controls and the diseases or whatever, and you know that there is there an unwanted source of noise, but you are not sure how the experiment was done, then you can use this RNA-seq method to correct the noise, okay? And just one warning, these methods were developed for microarrays, so if you are using them for sequencing data, maybe you have to transform them. You have to transform the data to before applying the methods. Okay. So, as I told you, RNA-seq is in NGS package. You don't need to provide the batch effect. It's good if you have. It's better if you have the batch information, but it can be applied if you don't have it. And what it does is applies the ASCA model. Which is the ASCA model? ASCA stands for ANOVA Simultaneous Component Analysis. ANOVA because when I have my count matrix or my quantification matrix, then I divide this matrix into the different effects. The effect of the conditions, the effect of the batch, if I have it, and then the residual part, which is this variability, which is not due either to the condition or to the batch. Okay, so a principal component analysis is applied onto each one of these matrices, and I extract the things I need from each of these submatrices. For instance, I extract the systematic variation of the condition because it's what I want to study. I extract the residual part of the batch information because this is the part of the variability which is not due to the batch effect. So I'm interested in this part, but I'm not considering the part which is due to the batch. And the same for the samples. Okay? So, this is for RNA-seq, it's a multivariate methodology. And then in combat, which is included in this bioconductor package, SBA, here we have to provide the batch information. And they somehow apply regression models for each gene, including the conditions, experimental conditions, and the batch as covariates. Okay? And they have there's parametric and non-parametric empirical variation methods to estimate the parameters. Okay, so and now I'm going to show you an example from a STATegra project in which we apply these technologies for you to see, and also because we had here an initial bad experimental design, and I wanted to show you how correct this. Okay? So remember, as David was telling you before, the data from STATegra is mouse data we have a differentiation, B-cell differentiation process. So we have this cell line in which the cell line is mutated in such a way that the cells are not differentiating. So under the control condition, the cells are not differentiating, but we induce the expression of a transcription factor called Icarus, which is very important for the differentiation process. And then this is this condition, and then Icarus triggers the differentiation. Okay? And then we have measured the different omics in different time points, and three replicates for each, we want to have at least three replicates for each time point and condition, at least for that. Okay, so in this case, I'm showing you the example of microRNA-seq, which is one of the omics we produce in this project. So in the first batch, let's say, we had data, as you can see here, we had all the Icarus conditions, all the time points for Icarus and all the replicates, but for the control condition, they only sequence the first time point and the last time point. Okay, and they say, okay, no, we want to have all the full time series. And they say, okay, then we will do a second sequencing run, and then in the second one, we will sequence the rest of control conditions, okay? The rest of control time points. So what happens if I do this, just the green ones, okay? Is that when I want to compare at 6 hours, for instance, the expression microarrays between control and between Icarus and control, I have that the effect of the batch is totally confused with the effect of Icarus. Okay, so it's not possible to separate them. So in order to avoid this situation and to be able afterwards to correct the batch effect, if it exists, not always, it's not always, maybe you do it and then you observe that the batch effect is not important and you don't have to correct it. But in order to see if this batch effect was there, and correct it, what we decided is to replicate some of the samples that had been sequenced in the first run, okay? So these ones in red are the ones, they are can be considered technical replicates because they were samples that were pre-sequenced, okay? So in this, as we have these replicate samples, we can estimate the magnitude of the batch. So we took the data, we perform TMM normalization, and then we have this principal component analysis plot to represent the data. You can see here that, okay, the solid shapes are for Icarus and the empty shapes are for control. So in principle, you say, okay, the separation is good between Icarus and control. The time points are not so well separated. These are the colors. But if you can see better the round shapes and the triangle shapes are indicating the two batches, and you can see that the two batches are perfectly separated in this plot. So there is a batch effect, and you need to correct for this batch effect. Okay? So we correct for this batch effect in this case using combat, although with our sim we got very similar results. And for combat, just also an advice for you: you have remember to give to combat not only the batches, but you have only to give the experimental conditions. So experimental conditions, we have two, the time points and the Icarus control condition. So what we did is to combine both of them to give to the method the least information, least amount of information possible. So we combine in this way, so the method knows that the three replicates for control 0 hours are the three replicates for this condition, the three replicates come together, so the method knows about the replicates, but the method doesn't know about which conditions are control or Icarus or which time points. Okay? So if you see here that now after the batch effect correction, the conditions are separated and the time points are perfectly aligned, 0, 2, 6, 2, 12, 18, and 24 hours, is because this information is in the data, because I haven't given it to the method. Okay? So, and you can see that the representation has improved a lot after correcting the batching. Okay. So, now we have all data prepared, we have removed clinical biases, batch effects, and so on. We can start with the statistical analysis, okay? So, the differential expression part. As you know, a gene, protein, genome enrichment, etc. is considered differential expressed if you observe a change in the read counts between the two conditions or more conditions you are studying. If you see that this change is statistically significant, what does it mean? That is, this change is higher than what we expect just by the natural random of the variation of the data. Okay. So, for instance, if we are comparing two conditions, statistically significant means that the difference between the two conditions is different from zero. And if, you can see an example here in which you have two genes and two conditions, and we can see the blue is the mean. So when you perform difference expression, you normally, not always, but you normally compare the means. Here you have, and here you can see that the difference between the means is more or less similar, but the differential expression methods consider also the variability of your data. In this case, this gene is not considered to be differentially expressed because this variability means that you consider that this difference between means is due to chance, and in this case, you are more sure that this gene is really differentially expressed. Okay? So, statistical approaches to obtain or to get these differential expressions, you have many. Univariate, multivariate, parametric, non-parametric, frequentist, Bayesian, a lot of them. Most sometimes you combine some of them. And I'm going to show you the most popular ones in this context. But for that, I need you to be aware of the nature of the data we have, okay? So, remember, if some of you have worked before with microarrays, you know with microarrays, we measure the intensity, and this is a continuous measurement. So in macroarrays, we consider that the data were normally distributed. And for microarrays, there were a lot of methods that were developed, and most of them considered that this distribution was a Gaussian distribution. Okay? When NGS technologies arrive, we have count data. Count data is discrete, so we cannot assume that this data is normally distributed anymore. So, which distribution do we have for this data? So, if we consider that I'm measuring the number of counts, of read counts for a given gene, and n is the total number of reads, and p the probability of a read belongs to this gene, then we could consider that the expression of a gene in these NGS technologies follows a binomial distribution. Okay? But as this is a reminder for you of statistics, popularity. So if we have a binomial distribution with a very high n and very small p, then we can approximate it with a Poisson distribution. But the Poisson distribution has a problem. Is that in the Poisson distribution, a problem in this context, I mean, it's not a problem in general. So in the Poisson distribution, the mean and the variance are equal. I don't know if you remember that, but they are equal. And they have observed that in this type of data, you have what they call an over dispersion, which means that the variance tends to be higher than the mean. So in order to model better this data, instead of considering a Poisson distribution, which was the first distribution they proposed at the beginning of these technologies, it's accepted now that this data follow a negative binomial distribution, which is a broader family of distribution, which includes the Poisson distribution. So I have a negative binomial, then I can have different variance and mean, and in the case that I have the same mean than variance, it's reduced to a Poisson distribution. Okay, but be careful with this, because I have seen many times that now I will tell you that there are some differential expression methods that are assuming this negative binomial distribution. Okay, so what happens if I perform normalization, and in this normalization I have transformed the data and I don't have counts anymore. So be careful with that, okay? So many normalization methods transform the data in such a way that I don't have counts anymore. So what the if you use a statistical method for the differential expression in which you have to assume this this distribution, be careful with that, okay? So there are two options there. In some cases, instead of correcting the data directly, you you get a constant, a normalization constant, and this method, this differential expression method, can accept this constant, so you give the data, the original data, and then the normalization constant, okay? This is a possibility, and another possibility is to consider if your, I mean, if the normalization you are applying is really, I mean, if the bias you have is so important that needs this this normalization, because if you are very interested in using a given differential expression method and you need counts for that, maybe imagine if you are using, I will give more details in a minute, HR, for instance. HR is a very popular method for differential expression, which is based on count data. You want to use, another reason, but you are interested in using HR, and you see that there is a small bias with the length. Okay, if you start to correct by the length and do transformations, the nature of your data is not discrete data anymore. Okay, so maybe the bias is not so important, and moreover, HR, for instance, is going to perform a different, or is going to generate a different model or different statistical analysis for each gene. Yeah, and genes normally are not compared among them. So as this bias, this length bias problem is affecting the comparison of the genes, maybe it's not important to correct at this point, okay? So there are a lot of considerations to make here, but I want you to think. Okay, so methods for differential expression in count data. Parametric methods, which mean that they are assuming that the data follow a certain distribution. Most of them, as I say, negative binomial distribution, like R, DT, or basic. Okay. Then we have LIMA. LIMA is a popular method we have for microarrays. I don't know if you have used it. And then in LIMA, they use, because in R or DT, for instance, they use, instead of linear models, regression linear models, which are based on the normally distributed data, they use generalized linear model. The generalized linear model are more flexible in this sense because they admit other distributions. So this is why here we can use the negative binomial distribution. In LIMA, they use the common linear models based on the normally distributed data. So what the authors of LIMA did is to propose a transformation of the data, which is called WOM, and with this transformation, you can apply, transform the data for them to have a normal distribution, and then you can apply the method. Okay? Then we have this MaCiclo method, which has been also developed in our group. And MaCiclo is especially used when you have time course data. For instance, in STATegra, we have time course data because we have Icarus and control conditions, but we have also a time series. Okay? And it's also based on generalized linear models, so you can use it either for normally distributed data or for count data. Okay. So, as we use for STATegra data, we use LIMA and MaCiPro. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about these two methodologies. Okay? So as I tell you, LIMA generates a linear model for each gene, in principle for microarrays, but with WOM transformation, we can apply it to read counts. Okay? So it accepts many different multifactorial designs, so it's not for comparing just two groups, but you can have many types of comparisons. And what happens, as we normally have in this omics data, we normally have a lot of genes, but the number of replicates we have for each condition is low. Okay, so estimate the variability for each condition is difficult with this few sample size, with this low sample size. So they use an empirical bias approach in order to borrow information across the years in order to better estimate the variability of the condition. Okay? So more or less it's what they do. Sorry. And then they return the statistics and they adjust this value for each of the contrast you are asking. For instance, in a STATegra, you can give Icarus control and all the time points. You can give all this information. It generates the model, but then you can say which are your specific questions, the contrast, the state. So you say which are the comparisons you want to make, and then generate the results. Okay? They have also more functionalities, not just the differential expression part, but also exploration, the data exploration and normalization, Venn diagrams to summarize the difference in expression results, and so on. Okay? So, and MaSeqPro. So, MaSeqPro is going to model the gene expression of a gene. It's also a different model for each gene. So, it's going to model the gene expression of a gene as a function of time, which is considered as a continuous covariate, and the condition. In our case, we have Icarus control and then the time. Okay? So, it compares for its condition, compares the profiles, the temporal profiles of the genes, and says, okay, these are the genes that are changing across time, and these are the genes that change in this way in control or in this way in Icarus in this case. Okay? So, it works in two different steps. First, the MaSeqPro estimates the model for all the genes, and then only those genes that have a statistically significant model go to the second step, and then the parameters of or the regression coefficients of each gene are estimated. And then also include different functionalities to cluster the genes, to represent graphically the profiles, etc. So these were parametric approaches, and then we have also non-parametric approaches that are methods that are not assuming any probability distribution for our data. So we have some of them, SAMSIC, NPV-seq, and also, as I already told you, we have differential expression in our package NoiseSeq. So at the beginning we have this NoiseSeq method for technical replicates at the beginning technologies when no biological replicates were being produced, and also when you have no replicates, but with biological replicates we adapted the method, it's called NoiseSeq. Okay, so, I think I'm out of time. This is more or less explanation of NoiseSeq, but I mean, this is material for you, you have the papers. And then I will go directly. This is the graphics for the results of differential expression. And all the methodologies I have been talking about can be used also for microRNA, CIPF-seq, ATAC-seq, whatever, as long as you have the quantification. But there is this paper in which they explain which are the methodologies you can use for CIPF-seq data. So SHARP is when you have transcription factor CIPF-seq data, and BROAD for histones modifications. And then these are the methods they suggest. But again, you can use the methods I have been telling you about. Okay. Okay. So now I think I will stop here. This is the functional enrichment. As we will see it also during the hands-on, I think it's better to explain it more carefully during this the hands-on session, because otherwise it's too much and I have to go to. Okay. So, I'll stop here. Okay. So, thank you very much for your attention, and you have two questions.